All right, folks, here we go again. We're going to do another Bible study. I guarantee you guys are going to like this one. This one's really good. Now, before we do the Bible study, which is basically I go through the Bible and we'll stop and chat along the way, before we do that, I want to tell you about some new features and some new free tools and new free gifts that are available to you. Now, if you look at the top of the page, see where it says shotgunnow.net right there? If you go to that website, I'll put it right below this video here. We have so many things. I'm going to fly through it real quick. We have our calendar of events, videos, links, important links to free tools you can get, downloads. We have our chat room. You can click here where it says chat room. Notice the, hopefully you see this globe spinning around. See all the little sparkly things and the little dots on the globe. We have a lot of people at the website right now. We have 22 people in the chat room. If you click this round button that says enter chat room, you can go there. Let's read from the bottom up. Definitely click here on the bottom where it says proof God exists right here. Apologetics 315. Let's see what else. My buddy Carl Gallups. If you're in the USA, you can get a free Israel USA flag pen. It's totally free. They ship it to you free also. And you can show your support for Israel. You have to be in the USA, though, to get it. I've had some people from other countries saying, oh, dang it, Shock. It's only for people in the USA. But if you're in the USA, click there. Reasonable Faith site, which is great if you're into apologetics and philosophy. Creation.com, excellent website also. Let's go. Oh, this is a really good site here, Contradictions Debunked. If you ever hear where people say, well, there's contradictions in the Bible, click right there where it says Contradictions Debunked, and you'll see that there are no contradictions in the Bible. Let's see what else we can show you. If you have a problem with your laptop getting hot, watch this video here. That'll help you. How to ride a motorcycle right here. And my radio show down here on the bottom. You can listen to some live debates we did. Oh, let's talk about that. And then we'll get to the Bible study. Notice in the middle here it says debates. And then there's also debates too. So I like to record debates that I've had with my sweet, huggable, lovable atheist friends. Bless their sweet little hearts. And most of them, by the time I'm done, they're not atheists at all. They're just theists that are suppressing the truth and unrighteousness. Free audiobooks, all types of things. If you want to back up your computer for free, click here. Actual first-person videos of street preaching right here. Got to check that out. My buddy Tally here. All types of stuff, guys. So let's get into the Bible study. And I am on a wireless headset, so hopefully I don't have any interference where my neighbor starts using a cell phone or something, and sometimes you might hear some static. But I like the wireless headset. It's great. Now, what we're going to do is we left off last time around Luke 18. We're going to start at Luke 19. Okay. Now, this is awesome, guys, that God plants himself in the tenthly flesh of this person, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is God. If you want to know the nature of God, God's personality, what God is like, the goodness of God, the holiness of God, look at Jesus Christ and you can get to know God. If you want to know what God's like, look at Jesus Christ. So let me show you Jesus Christ. Watch this. He's entering in and he's passing through Jericho. And check this out. This is pretty cool. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus. Now, Zacchaeus, which was the chief among the publicans, and he was rich. Now, Zacchaeus here, he's a publican, which a lot of the Jews didn't like the publicans because they basically worked for Rome collecting money for Rome, like tax collectors. So, of course, the Jews really didn't like them, right? But notice this. He's a shorter guy. He's not tall, right? And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and he could not for the press, because there's a crowd and he can't look over them. notice, because he was little of stature, so he's short. And he ran before, so he runs in front of the crowd trying to predict which way Jesus is going to walk, and he climbs up into a sycamore tree. So look at this. This is pretty cool. He's fascinated with this person, Jesus Christ, and he wants to see, but he can't even get close because the crowds are just surrounding Jesus as he's walking from place to place. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up. So imagine you're Zacchaeus, and all of a sudden the whole crowd stops, and Jesus looks at you straight in the eye. He's looking up at you. Pretty cool, huh? And he says to Zacchaeus, make haste, like, hurry up, come down, for today I must abide at your house. I bet you'd be like, oh, this is so epic. Jesus is coming to my house, right? And of course, that's what happened. And he made haste. He climbs down the tree and he receives Jesus joyfully. I mean, he's like in his glory that Jesus is going to stay with him. And when they saw it, the crowd, because they knew that Zacchaeus was a pretty bad dude, you know, a publican, they don't like these tax collectors, they all murmured, saying, oh, brother, look at it. Jesus is going to be a guest with a man that is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, he's probably hoping, oh no, I hope Jesus doesn't change his mind. He goes, Lord, behold, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. And Jesus, knowing his heart, Zacchaeus' heart, says, this day is salvation come to this house. And he sticks up for Zacchaeus. For so much as he also is a son of Abraham. So Zacchaeus is now in with Jesus Christ, and they're very good friends here. And Jesus says, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. And as they heard these things, he added and spake a parable, because he was nigh to Jerusalem. So he's almost to Jerusalem, and everyone's thinking, this is it. The kingdom of God's going to appear. They're thinking, this is it, the moment they've all been waiting for, right? This is what Jesus says. He says, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. And he called his 10 servants and delivered them 10 pounds and said unto them, occupy till I come. But his citizens hated him and sent a message after him, saying, we will not have this man to reign over us. And it came to pass that when he was returned, having received the kingdom, then he commanded these servants to be called unto him to whom he had given the money, that he might know how much every man had gained by trading. Then came the first, saying, Lord, thy pound hath gained 10 pounds. And he said unto him, well, thou good servant, because thou hast been faithful in very little, have thou authority over 10 cities. And the second came, saying, Lord, thy pound hath gained 5 pounds. And he said likewise to him, be thou also over 5 cities. And another came, saying, Lord, behold, here is thy pound, which I have kept laid up in a napkin. For I feared thee, because thou art an austere man. Thou takest up that thou layest not down, and reapest that thou didst not sow. And he said unto him, so the Lord says unto this person, out of thine own mouth, look, will I judge thee, thou wicked servant. Thou knewest that I was an austere man, taking up that I laid not down, and reaping that I did not sow. Wherefore then gavest not thou my money into the bank, that at my coming I might have required mine own with usury? In other words, well, why didn't you do something with the money? Why did you just sit on it? Why didn't you at least put it in the bank so I'd get some interest on it, right? And he said unto them that stood by, take from him the pound. So the guy that only has a pound, now he even loses that, right? And give to him that hath the 10 pounds. So basically, he takes from the guy that doesn't have that much, and he gives it to the guy that did the best return on the money that was entrusted with him. And they said unto him, Lord, he hath 10 pounds. For I say unto you, Jesus says, that unto every one which hath shall be given, and from him that has not, even that he has shall be taken away from him. But those mine enemies, which would not that I should reign over them, bring hither and slay them before me. And when he had thus spoken, he went before ascending up to Jerusalem. Now, don't forget to click below this video in the description to listen to an actual debate. I debated an atheist, and a very kind person. At the end of the debate, and you'll see in the comment section, he admitted that he lost the debate. He was taking the side of atheism, I was taking the side of Christianity, and my atheist opponent admitted that he lost. But during the debate, my atheist opponent makes a mistake, and he says that Jesus stole a donkey. Well, that's not really true, but you'll hear my atheist opponent make that mistake in the debate, and let's go through this part here. So, Jesus says, he sends two of his disciples saying, "Go ye into the village over against you, in the which at your entering you shall find a colt tied, whereon yet never man sat." In other words, no one sat on this colt yet. "Loose him and bring him hither. And if any man ask you, why do ye loose him? You shall say unto him, because the Lord has need of him." So notice, it doesn't say that Jesus stole the donkey. Evidently what happened here is Jesus beforehand went and prepared this donkey for his triumphant entry. And also, when you go to shotgunl.net, click Passion of the Christ, and you can watch this clip of the movie where Jesus is on this colt, this donkey, as he's heading into Jerusalem. So watch this. Let's see. Okay, so, "And they went," the two disciples go, "and they found even as he said unto them." So they find the colt there. "And as they were loosening the colt, the owners thereof said unto them, why loose ye the colt?" Like, where are you taking the colt? Why? "And they said, the Lord hath need of him." So notice, the owners allow the colt to be taken. So evidently they were familiar with what was going to happen. "And they brought him to Jesus, and they cast their garments upon the colt, and they set Jesus thereon." And this is a ultra beautiful, epic moment. When you go to shotgunl.net, right below this video, make sure you look at the top there, all those links I was showing you, and click Passion of the Christ, and you'll see this part from a first-person perspective, as if you yourself were on the donkey. And as the donkey's moving forward, here's what's happening. You'll see this clip in the movie. "And as he went, they spread their clothes in the way." So picture this epic moment. Here you have God, Jesus Christ, on this donkey, and as he's coming through, everyone's throwing their clothes and spreading their clothes in front of him in honor for him. And notice, "And when he was come nigh, even now at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen." So it's really just an epic moment. And here's what the crowd's saying. "Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven, and glory in the highest." "And some of the Pharisees from among the multitude said unto him, Master," so they're saying this to Jesus, "rebuke your disciples." Like, don't let him say this. And look what Jesus says. In other words, what Jesus is saying here is, look, you're not going to stop it. This is my destiny. This is literally what Jesus is getting at here. Look what he says. "And he answered and said unto them," and this is just awesome. He says, "I tell you that if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out." You can't stop his destiny. "And when he was come near, he beheld the city," and picture this, everyone's looking at him, and one of the very rare moments in Scripture, Jesus starts crying. And he, as he's weeping, he says, "If thou hast known, even thou, at least in this thy day, the things which belong unto thy peace, but now they are hid from thine eyes," and he's speaking of the future of that area. And he says, "For the day shall come upon thee that thine enemies shall cast a trench about thee and compass thee round and keep thee on every side, and shall lay thee even with the ground, and thy children within thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon the other, because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. And he went into the temple and began to... Now watch this. He goes into the temple and he starts overthrowing the money changers, and there's other passages that say he fashioned like a little whip. This is sweet, meek, gentle Jesus doing this, guys, in our continuing series of things Jesus said that may shock you. He goes into the temple and they kind of turned it into like a business there, and he starts overthrowing the tables, the money changers, and he's driving all these people out, and he's very passionate about his house. And he said unto them, notice, and he went to the temple and began to cast out them that sold therein and them that bought, saying unto them, it is written, my house is the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. And he taught daily in the temple, but the chief priests and the scribes and the chief of the people sought to destroy him, and could not find what they might do, for all the people were very attentive to hear him. They were fascinated with Jesus Christ. And it came to pass that on one of those days, as he taught in the temple and preached the gospel, the chief priests and the scribes came upon him with the elders. So they're basically saying, let's just all go confront him. And they're wanting to, basically in front of everyone, they want to put Jesus in his place, so they think, right? But watch how Jesus silences them. And they spake unto Jesus, saying, tell us. Notice, they're telling God, they're telling him, by what authority do you do these things? Or who is he that gave you this authority? And then, this is awesome, look what Jesus says. Rather than just meekly and mildly answer them, what he does is he questions them with authority. And he says to them, I will also ask you one thing, and answer me. The baptism of John, he says, was it from heaven or of men? And they reasoned with themselves, saying, well, if we say from heaven, Jesus is going to say, why didn't you believe him? But if we say of men, like in other words, John wasn't really sent by God, he was just a regular man, he said, then all the people will stone us, for they persuaded that John was a prophet. So Jesus throws them this curveball question, showing how, well, let me just let the passage read for itself. Watch this. And they answered that they could not tell whence it was. So what Jesus does is he says to them, well, then neither tell I you by what authority I do these things. You see how he does that? Sometimes what I'll do too, I'll use this, you know, really in my personal life, when I'm talking to unbelievers, and they'll come and they'll question me about a lot of things in Scripture, and I'll answer them, but it's a two-way street. They have to answer me also. For example, a lot of my atheist friends will come to me and they'll say, well, do you believe this, that, and the other? I go, yeah, I believe that, but I have a question for you. What proof and evidence do you have that atheism is accurate and correct? And then, of course, they always respond like the scribes and the chief priest here. They don't have any proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct, as you'll hear that they don't have any when you click below this video and you listen to the debate there that we had. So notice, this next scripture is great if you're witnessing to Muslims. Muslims will say that Jesus is just a good and wise teacher. But you can't really say that, because Jesus allowed people to worship him. He claimed to be alive before Abraham was. He said that he's the only person that has seen the Father. He was asked if he was the Messiah. He said he was the Son of God, which is one of the main reasons why they had Jesus killed. So you can't say Jesus was just a good and wise prophet, because watch this parable here, which clearly shows that Jesus is the very living Son of God himself. Then he began to speak to the people this parable. And remember this, Luke 29, if you're witnessing to Muslims. A certain man planted a vineyard, Jesus says, and led it forth to husbandmen, you know, the hired workers, and went into a far country for a long time. And at that season, he sent a servant to the husbandmen. Now remember, the servants represent prophets that God is sending to the people, right? That they should give of him the fruit of the vineyard, but the husbandmen beat him and sent him away empty. And again he sent another servant. In other words, God keeps sending these prophets to the people. And they beat him also, and entreated him shamefully, and sent him away empty. And again he sent a third, and they wounded him also, and cast him out. Now watch what happens here. And Jesus is referring to himself here. And this is why this is great to witness to Muslims. Then said the Lord of the vineyard, what shall I do? I will send my beloved son. Notice, he's not just a prophet like these other guys. It may be they will reverence him when they see him, but when the husbandmen saw him, they reasoned among themselves, saying, ah, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him, that the inheritance may be ours. So they cast him out of the vineyard and killed him. So what Jesus is doing, that's referring to him. So then Jesus says, what therefore shall the Lord of the vineyard do unto them? And look what he says. He shall come and destroy these husbandmen, and shall give the vineyard to others. And when they heard it, they said, God forbid. And he beheld them and said, what is this then that is written? The stone which the builders rejected, the same is become the head of the corner. Whosoever shall fall upon that stone shall be broken, but on whomsoever it shall fall, it will grind him to powder. Now, this really rubs the chief priests and scribes the wrong way, because they know that Jesus is talking about them. And from that hour, they sought, notice, to lay hands on him, and they feared the people, for they perceived that he had spoken this parable against them. And they watched him, and sent forth spies which should feign themselves just men, that they might take hold of his words, so that they might deliver him under the power and authority of the governor. So they're trying to get him in trouble, or make something up, something, some charge to bring against him. So they get these guys to ask him these trick questions, and they asked him, saying, Master, and notice they pour on the syrup to make it seem like they're on his side. Master, we know that thou sayest and teachest rightly, neither acceptest thou the person of any, but teachest the way of God truly. Is it lawful for us to give tribute unto Caesar, or no? But Jesus, perceiving their craftiness, said unto them, why are you trying to tempt me? Why tempt ye me? Shew me a penny. Show me a penny whose image and superscription has it. They answered and said, Caesar's. And he said unto them, well, render therefore unto Caesar the things which be Caesar's, and unto God the things which be God's. So they just could not out-debate him. They couldn't outspeak him. They're just not even in his league. And they could not, notice, and they could not take hold of his words before the people, and even his enemies, look, and they marveled at his answer and held their peace. I mean, they were just like shocked. Then came to him certain of the Sadducees, which deny that there is any resurrection. So the Sadducees don't believe in the resurrection, right? So they asked Jesus another trick question, saying, Master, Moses wrote unto us, if any man's brother die having a wife, and he die without children, that his brother should take his wife and raise up seed unto his brother. So they give Jesus this straw man argument, we'll call it, little made up argument, and he says there were seven brothers, and the first took a wife and died without children, then the second married her, and then he also died, and then the third, I mean, it's just like some made up story, right? But they're really going to try to make it difficult for Jesus to answer. So, and the third took her, and basically they say, so basically all seven people married this woman, and all of them died. Right? So they give this really exaggerated question, you know, to Jesus, like, let's see you get out of this one, right? So now watch this. Last of all, they say the woman died also. She's like, if you can't beat him, then join him. So she dies too, right? So then they ask him the question, they think, we got him now. Therefore, in the resurrection, whose wife of them is she? For seven had her to wife. So they think, we got him now. He can't say that she's married to all of them. And so he's going to have to say that either he's married to the first one or, you know, so they think they got him, right? So look what Jesus says. He said unto them, the children of this world marry and are given in marriage, but watch this, but they which shall be accounted worthy to obtain that world, he's referring to heaven, and the resurrection from the dead, notice, neither marry nor are given in marriage. So there is no marriage in heaven. He says, neither can they die anymore, because you notice these Sadducees are talking about this person died, that person died, and they're all talking about death, right? And Jesus basically says, you know, you don't even know what you're talking about here. He goes, neither can they die anymore, for they are equal unto the angels and are the children of God, notice, being the children of the resurrection. Now that the dead are raised, even Moses shewed at the bush when he calleth the Lord the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. And Jesus basically shows them their error here. He goes, look, for he is not a God of the dead, but of the living. For all live unto him. Then certain of the scribes, notice not all of them, but some of them that probably had a good heart, they said, Master, thou hast well said. There were some in the crowd that said, you know what? That is amazing. That's true. That was a brilliant answer. And they agree with Jesus. And after that, they durst not ask him any question at all. They're like, they just kind of like wimpily went back into their corner. And again, they realized Jesus is totally out of their league. And Jesus said unto them, how do they say that Christ is David's son? And David himself saith in the book of Psalms, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou up my right hand, till I make thine enemies thy footstool. David therefore calleth him Lord, how is he then his son? Then in the audience of all the people he said unto his disciples, beware of the scribes which desire to walk in long robes and love greetings in the markets and the highest seats in the synagogues and the chief rooms of at feast, which devour widows' houses and for a show make long prayers, the same shall receive greater damnation. Notice what Jesus is saying here. He's talking about damnation. Now, as he's there at the temple, he's seeing people come in and they're casting money in for the temple, right? And he looked and he saw the rich men casting their gifts into the treasury. So then this raggedy old widow, right? She's real poor. She comes hobbling along. Picture this. And he saw also a certain poor widow casting in thither two mites, basically like pennies, you know. And Jesus, he draws attention to this woman and he says, of a truth I say unto you, he's telling the people around him, that this poor widow hath cast in more than they all. So he's, notice Jesus is looking at the heart, that this woman is giving basically everything that she owns. And he says, for all these have of their abundance cast in unto the offerings of God, but she gave of her penury hath cast in all the living that she had. And as some spake of the temple, how it was adorned with goodly stones and gifts, he said, as for these things which you behold, the days will come in which there shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And he was prophesying the destruction of the temple, which did happen. And they asked him, saying, Master, but when shall these things be? And what sign will there be when these things shall come to pass? And he said, take heed that you be not deceived, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and the time draweth near. Go ye not therefore after them. So he's also talking about false Christ. And then he says, but when you shall hear of wars and commotions, be not terrified, for these things must first come to pass. But notice, Jesus is referring to the end, but the end is not by and by. Then he said unto them, nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and great earthquakes shall be in divers places, and famines and pestilences, and fearful sights and great signs shall there be from heaven. But before all these, so notice, before all that happens, what happens? He says, they shall lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and into prisons, being brought before kings and rulers for my name's sake. And it shall turn to you for a testimony. Settle it therefore in your hearts not to meditate before what you shall answer. So basically he's saying, look, when you get arrested and persecuted for being a Christian, don't even plan what you're going to say, because the Spirit will guide you on what to say. He says, for I will give you a mouth and wisdom. Notice Jesus Christ, he's going to give you mouth and wisdom, notice, which all your adversaries shall not be able to gainsay nor resist. Like, you're going to be able to outspeak them. And you shall be betrayed, notice this, both by parents and brethren and kinsfolks and friends, and some of you shall they cause to be put to death. And you shall be hated of all men for my name's sake. But there shall not a hair of your head perish. In your patience possess ye your souls. And then he prophesies here again, and when you shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out, and let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto. For these be the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. And watch what happens here. He's referring to a time in the future, pretty evil times. He says, but woe unto them that are with child and to them that give suck in those days, for there shall be great distress in the land and wrath upon this people. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. Now, what Jesus is talking about, it has not happened yet within the history of the world. This is something that is supposed to be happening within the future. And it's so terrifying that Jesus talks about people literally having just heart attacks out of fear. He says, men's hearts failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. So basically it's building up to this climactic event where you have the wars, you have nations going against nations, you have pestilence, famines, you have all this. You also have, it appears here in the universe, you have things happening in the universe. He talks about the sun and the moon, the stars, the earth having distress of nations, the sea and the waves roaring. And then it gets so bad that even people, their hearts, notice men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. What does that mean, for looking after those things? Evidently, most likely, it could be that in the news they're talking about predictions of what's going to happen to the earth as the heavens are shaken and as wars are happening, and I guess it's just so terrifying that their hearts start failing them. This is what Jesus Christ says. And then look what happens. And then they shall see the Son of Man coming in a cloud, notice, with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up. So notice, Jesus tells us as believers to look up when this happens. Lift up your heads, and this is excellent news for those of us that are saved, for your redemption draweth nigh. And he spake to them a parable. Behold the fig tree and all the trees. When they now shoot forth, you see and know of your own selves that summer is now nigh at hand. So likewise, when you see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass away till all be fulfilled. Now, sometimes I'll talk to my unbelieving friends, bless their sweet little hearts, and they'll say, well, look, it says this generation. Yeah, he's not talking, he's talking about not the people that he's talking to there. He's talking about the generation that witnesses these things. It shall not pass away till Jesus returns. See that? He says this generation, which generation? The one he was just talking about, shall not pass away till all be fulfilled. Sometimes someone that hasn't read scripture, they'll read one little phrase like this and they won't read it all, the whole thing in its context, and they'll get the wrong impression. Remember, you want to read everything the proper way. Don't just read a sentence out of context and mess you up. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. Now, this is a stern warning here for all of us. It's interesting that he says this, and take heed to yourselves. Why would he say that to you and I? He says, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares. In other words, you know, he's saying, you know, concentrate. Remember, you're not of this world. We're passing through. Don't get so caught up into the cares of, notice, the cares of this life, which is just temporary. And that day comes upon us, it sneaks up on us. So he says, take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares. And notice what he says, for as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch ye therefore and pray some of the time, half the time, whenever you get chance to do it. No. Look what he says, guys. And pray always, that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things. Notice, it's not a good thing that's coming to the earth. Otherwise, Jesus wouldn't talk about the escaping of it. He says, pray always that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. Notice, that shall come to pass, not that might come to pass, not that could come to pass, that shall come to pass. Okay, let's wrap it up here. And in the daytime he was teaching in the temple, and at night he went out and abode in the mount that is called the Mount of Olives. And all the people came early in the morning to him in the temple for to hear him. Now, let's try to finish up on this page. I love reading the Bible, guys, so one of these days we're going to do like a marathon where we just keep reading, but I'll try to end it on this page. Now the feast of the unleavened bread drew nigh, which is called the Passover. And the chief priests and scribes sought how they might kill him, for they feared the people. They're like, well, how can they do it without the people protecting, without the people protecting him? Then entered Satan, notice, into Judas, surnamed Iscariot, being the number of the 12. So it's interesting, Satan enters into Judas. And he went his way and communed with the chief priest and captain. So Judas basically stabs Jesus in the back, and he wants some money for it. And they were glad that he betrayed Jesus, and they basically gave him some money to do it. So Judas promises that he'll, when he has an opportunity to betray him, notice, unto them in the absence of the multitude. So he wants to time it right, because the multitude's always falling around Jesus Christ. They can't get to him with this multitude, because they would stick up for Jesus and probably attack the multitude were people like you and I, right? The average Joes. And it's interesting that the multitude are people like you and I, just sinners. And it's interesting that it's the religious nut jobs that are actually the ones trying to kill Jesus, but the people like you and I that are just sinners, you know, nothing special, just average people, were the ones that were very good friends of Jesus, and Jesus would hang out with us. So, then came the day of the unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed. So Jesus sends Peter and John, saying, go and prepare us the Passover, that we may eat. And they said unto him, where wilt thou that we prepare? So Jesus says unto them, behold, when you are entered into the city, there shall be a man that meets you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he entereth in. And you shall say unto the good man of the house, the master saith unto thee, where is the guest chamber where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he shall show you a large upper room furnished, there make ready. And they went and found as he said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. And when the hour was come, he sat down, and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them, with desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. So this is just amazing. I find this just remarkable. Imagine, you know you're going to die, and what's happening here is, when you're going to the cross, it's the ultimate expression of God's love for you and I. Jesus going to the cross and dying and resurrecting is God's love letter to us. He's showing us how much he loves us, right? I mean, just this intense love. God is holy. God is just. He must judge sin. And in this brilliant example, he sends his son, Jesus Christ, as the most intense, powerful expression of love ever, to say, hey, you know what? I know you guys are sinners. I'm going to take your punishment. I mean, think about that, how much God loves us. It's just amazing. It's an expression of love. And he says to them, for I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. And he took bread and gave thanks and brake it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. Then he talks about Judas. But behold, the hand of him that betrayeth me is with me on the table. I mean, you probably could have heard a pin drop when he said that. And truly the Son of Man goeth as it was determined, but woe unto that man by whom he is betrayed. And so they start freaking out because they know Jesus knows this, right? So they began to inquire among themselves which of them it was that should do this thing. And there was also a strife among them which of them should be accounted the greatest. And he said unto them, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and they that exercise authority upon them are called benefactors. So he's talking about how, you know, if you want to be great, you know, in this world, you basically rise up over someone and you exercise this lordship over them, right? But it's interesting, look what Jesus says, but you shall not be so. Like, but you're not going to play that game. You're not going to be that way. He says, but he that is greatest among you, let him be as the younger, and he that is chief as he that doth serve. For whether is greater, he that sitteth at meat or he that serveth? Is it not he that sitteth at meat, but I am among you as he that serveth? You are they which continued with me in my temptations, and I appoint unto you a kingdom as my Father hath appointed unto me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, imagine that you're Peter, right? And this is pretty scary stuff here. Jesus looks at him and he says, Peter, I mean, this is just amazing. He looks at him, and it's Simon Peter, so he says, and the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. That's pretty scary stuff. That's heavy. I would have, like, freaked out, you know. But I have prayed for thee, that thy faith fail not. And when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. And he said unto them, Lord, I am ready to go with thee both into prison and to death. And he said, I tell thee, Peter, the cock shall not crow this day before thou shalt thrice deny that thou knowest me. Now, don't forget to click below shockonal.net. When you go there, click Passion of the Christ, and you can see this very sad part where Peter denies Jesus, and then he comes to his senses and he realizes that he just sold Jesus out and he denied him because he was afraid to go to prison and to get beat up, right? So they're about to go into very dangerous territory. Jesus is going to be leaving them go to the cross. So look what Jesus says. This is another one of those shocking things that Jesus says. Then he said unto them, when I sent you without purse and scrip and shoes, lacked ye anything? Because remember earlier on in our Bible studies, he sends them out to preach the gospel, and he tells them not to bring anything with them. They basically go out on faith. They don't have any money with them or, you know, anything, right? And he said, did you lack anything? And they said, nothing. So everything, you know, people were giving them food. People were taking care of them and everything, and they just stepped out on faith. But now they're heading into some dangerous territory. They're coming up to some scary times, terrifying times. Now look what Jesus says to them. And this probably, I mean, if I was there at that time, I'd be like freaking out. You know, I'd be like, why is Jesus telling me this, right? Then said he unto them, but now. That's how it starts. But now. He that hath a purse, let him take it, and likewise his scrip. And he that hath no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. So he's telling them, make sure you have a sword ready. For I say unto you that this that is written must yet be accomplished in me. And he was reckoned among the transgressors, for the things concerning me have an end. And they said, Lord, behold, here are two swords. Evidently there's some swords there already. And he said unto them, it is enough. And he came out and went, as he was wont, to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples also followed him. Now, I'm going to stop here. Now, where I'm stopping here, where Jesus starts praying, where like it appears like these great drops of blood are coming out of him, this is where the Passion of the Christ movie begins. It begins where I'm stopping. So you see where it says shotgunowl.net? Let me show you something. I'm going to go to the site right now out of respect to you guys so I can show you something. All right, when you go to shotgunowl.net, right here, see it says Speed Up PC, Illuminati, Contradictions Debunked, Debates, and to the right of Debates right here it says Passion of the Christ. Click that. When you click it, you click this right here and you can watch the entire movie of Passion of the Christ. It's the best movie ever. When you click it, it'll also go full screen. So God bless you guys. I love you. This is Shock. Have a great week.